Hello. So today I'm going to be talking about the Grand Canonical Ensemble, Gibbs Factor, the Gibbs sum. I'm going to be proving, you know, each thing, and also going to be proving the energy and average number of particles. So average energy, average number of particles. But it's going to take a little bit. So, what the Grand Canonical Ensemble is we have a constant chemical potential, volume, and temperature. Okay. Now, this is all in a reservoir, and say we have a subsystem that's in thermal and diffusive equilibrium, okay? So that means that energy can flow and particles can flow from one system to the other, okay? So we can make some equations out of this. We could say the multiplicity, or actually the probability of being in a certain state is equal to, or divided by, the probability of being in a second state, is equal to the multiplicity of that first state. So what we have is changing energy and changing number of particles. So let's say we have the total number of particles minus the number of particles in this subsystem, comma, the total energy minus the energy of that first subsystem, divided by the probability of state two can be represented by the multiplicity of that state, so n minus n2, nu minus epsilon 2. Now, the reason we could say this division of probabilities is because they're over the same total. So if you think about it, those are going to cancel out. So we could say the division of their multiplicities is equivalent to the division of their probabilities. So now we're going to convert our multiplicity here into entropy, all right? And all you have to do to get entropy is throw an ln in, ln. But to throw that into the formula, we're going to need to raise e to the power of that, okay? So we're not breaking any rules of math here. And ln of g, or ln of the multiplicity, is the entropy, which is denoted by sigma. So we could say e to the sigma, or entropy, of n minus n1 and u minus epsilon 1 over e to the sigma n minus n2 u minus epsilon 2. Okay? Erase this. All right. So we can also say it's this minus this in a single base, all right? So we could say E to the entropy of system 1 minus the entropy of system 2. Another way of saying that is delta sigma. Okay, so that's probably an easier way of doing it. So now we're going to use the Taylor series. To write this equation out. Okay? And we're just going to do the first one because the second one is the exact same, just with different subscripts. So for entropy n minus n1, comma, u minus epsilon, we have sigma of the total number of particles and the total energy minus n1 times the partial derivative of sigma with respect to n, holding u constant, minus u, or energy 1, partial derivative of sigma with respect to u, holding number of particles constant. We're going to plug that into both of these, okay? So we get when we do that? Probability of state 1 over probability of state 2 equals we have this first equation. We copy that. Minus the second set, okay? So the only thing that's changing are the subscripts. We're going to keep everything else. And these will become plus because we're subtracting it. Partial sigma over partial u. Okay, kind of hard to see there, but it's the general picture. The only thing that changed from here to here are the subscripts. So it's all the same other than that. So we can cancel some stuff out, and we're gonna rename some stuff as well. So those cancel. And we get here, we have negative chemical potential divided by temperature, and here, and same over here, we have 1 over temperature, okay? So let's plug those in. We'll rewrite it a little bit differently. So we have probability of state 1 and probability of state 2 equals e to the positive, because these are two negatives, cancel out, N1 mu over tau minus epsilon 1 over tau plus, actually minus, because this is negative mu over tau, so it's going to be minus N2 mu over tau minus, actually plus epsilon 2 over tau. All right. So now we can rewrite this as probability of state 1 over probability of state 2 equals, we're going backwards kind of now, e to the n1 mu minus epsilon 1 over tau over e to the n2 mu minus epsilon 2 over tau. All right, so this is where our Gibbs factor comes from, all right? Because we can relate this to 1 over the Gibbs sum. So cursive z. If we scramble this equation around a little bit. Now, we only know this because of the fundamental assumption, which is all accessible states in a closed system are equally likely. So, all accessible states in a closed system are equally likely. That's why we can do this. And we're going to kind of cross-multiply here and get a new equation. And that's going to give us the Gibbs sum, the Gibbs factor. So we have probability of state 1 over e to the n1 mu minus epsilon 1 over tau equals probability of state 2 over e to the n2 mu minus epsilon 2 over tau. And then we could say that the probability of a single state is equal to, by multiplying this to here, e the n1 mu minus epsilon 1 over tau divided by the sum of every single one of those states. So here is our Gibbs factor. All of these combined, and 1 and 2 and 3, up to however many you have, is going to be the Gibbs sum. Okay, so we could say that Z is the sum of all states and numbers . So that's N and energies. So these two things. E, the N, let's say I, U, minus E, I, over 10. Okay. Okay, so now given our Gibbs sum, and instead of saying all states and numbers over time, we say ASN. We have E to the power of N1. Actually, let's just say N. I minus, or mu minus EI over tau. We can actually get rid of the subscripts. But these are our changing variables, and they're R in the sum. It's actually a double sum, but okay. So we're going to find the average number of particles. Now there's a trick to doing this. The trick is take the derivative, partial derivative, of Z, or the Gibbs sum with respect to mu. So if we do that, really you can almost totally block this out. If we take the derivative with respect to U, since that's to the power of 1, we just get n over tau on the outside. So we'd say, okay, this is sigma n over tau of the same thing, okay, because the derivative of E gives you itself with the derivative of the inside. So it's a chain rule. So we have n u minus epsilon over tau. There. Now we can fiddle with this a little bit. To get the average number of particles, you got to remember what the average formula is for any average. Average value is equal to the sum of all the probabilities times the individual probability. And so we really don't have exactly this here. We have most of it. We have the N, we have this. We have an extra piece. We have tau here. So we can pull that out. And actually, instead, let's multiply it over to the other side. Let's say tau dz d mu equals sum of n times e to the n mu minus epsilon over tau. Still don't have what we need to get this, because probability of our state is this. So we need to divide by z to actually get what we want. So let's divide by z on both sides. So this is our average number of particles. But let's rewrite it in an easier form. It's actually way easier to deal with when you do this too. The derivative of the inside divided by the inside is the same as the derivative of the natural log of that function. equals, well, the average number of particles. So that is the proof for average number of particles in the grand canonical ensemble. Let's do the same thing for energy, but when we are finding the average energy, what we do is we take the derivative with respect to temperature instead. And I'm actually missing temperature right here, which I just noticed. Let's put that in. All right, so the average energy, we're going to take the derivative with respect to temperature. Okay, so this derivative with respect to temperature, well, that's T to the negative 1, right? We can say. All right, so we take the derivative of the inside, and we'll keep the summation, ASM. That's all constant while we do this derivative. So we should denote that somewhere here. We have N mu minus epsilon. You subtract 1, right? So that's going to be over negative tau squared, okay? Times the same thing. And then again, we could take some stuff out of this. So we could take out the negative tau squared, we multiply it to the other side, and we'll leave this, but we're going to call it something a little bit different. We also have to do that trick with the z where we divide both sides by z. So let's go ahead and do that now. We divide both by the Gibbs sum. That'll mean these times this is an average. And we're going to multiply by negative tau squared. We're going to call this ln of z. And we're going to call the average of this. So we can do a little bit more with this, because when you have an average with multiple terms in it, you can break that up. So we can say negative tau squared partial derivative ln z over derivative with respect to t equals. So remember I said there's two things that are not constant here. We have, well, mu is constant, so we could pull that out, times the average number of particles minus the average energy. And we want this, because that's a mu, right? So we're going to solve for that. So we'll add this to this side, we'll add this to this side, and we'll get u equals mu times n plus tau squared times partial derivative of ln z over partial derivative of tau. But we know n. We just write that here. So we have kind of a final answer here. We have the average energy of our system equals mu times tau partial ln z with respect to mu plus tau squared partial ln z with respect to tau. And that's it for today.